Oh, it's Mr. True. If you were just watching that video about complex numbers, you saw the video run out. You missed the big bam! And I tried to squeeze in a solution of a parabola in the last 2.5 minutes and clearly ran out of time. So since I've got to make a whole new video, because I don't want to take the time to stitch these together, I'm already doing a lot of teaching after school, and at home this load-up time is pretty substantial. So let me just go a little bit slower through that parabola question and give you a better lesson anyway. So part two of complex numbers. We're going to try and solve or find out the solutions to this parabola. Now, graphing, when you talk about solutions, you're talking about x-intercepts. So what I really want to find, if I want to solve or find the roots or the solutions or the zeros, all the same thing, of this parabola, I want to know where it crosses the x-axis. Now, when you cross the x-axis, the y-value is zero, yeah? So if this is a parabola, what I'm really solving in this problem is 0 equals 2x squared plus 12x plus 20. What's the y-intercept of this parabola? What's the solution? We know it's a parabola because there's one squared term. Well, this might factor, but I want to go through the quadratic formula for you. And if you did watch the last video, you'll see a little bit of repeat here, but it's only about a minute. When you have an equation in standard form, that's where the degrees count down by 1 and it's set equal to 0, a quadratic. This first term is A, then B, then C. And we're going to solve this using the quadratic formula, which is the opposite of B plus or minus the square root of B squared minus 4AC all over 2A. Okay, well, B is 12, so negative 12 plus or minus the square root of b squared. Always use parentheses when you do substitution, helps you save on your sign errors. Minus 4a times c, which is 20, all over 2a. Okay, so we have negative 12 plus or minus the square root. This is 144 minus 160 all over 4. Now, here's where we get into the imaginary numbers and complex values. 144 minus 160 is negative 16. So we get 12, negative 12, plus or minus the square root of negative 16 over 4. Now, if it was any other math area, like if you were just early, like earlier in the math year, or in algebra 1 or geometry, you might just stop and say there's no solution. But we are studying complex numbers, the imaginary solution. So we're going to keep going. The square root of negative 1 is I, and the square root of 16 is 4. So this becomes negative 12 plus or minus 4i over 4. Both of these terms have a factor of 4 that we can cancel with the bottom. That's 4 times negative 3, 12 divided by 4 is negative 3, plus or minus 4 divided by 4 is 1, so I over 4. And those common factors cancel out. So we have our imaginary solution of 3 plus or minus I. Now, a couple of things before I move on and try not to run out of time again, is when you're solving equations and you get a solution that is imaginary or complex, they always show up in pairs. Why? Because what is an imaginary number? An imaginary number is the square root, or attempting to take the square root, of a negative number. Well, when you take the square root of a number, you're always getting a positive and a negative answer. That is why your complex numbers always show up as conjugate. This is a binomial with the middle term changing sign. Complex numbers as solutions always show up as conjugate pairs because you're square rooting a number, and when you square root a number, even though it happens to be negative and it comes out as I, you have a positive and negative answer. So a little bit better lesson than my rush job if you watched the last video. Why does this parabola not have an x-intercept? Well, depending on where you are, if you're studying conic sections, you might be looking at completing the square and putting this into what's called, standard form of a parabola. That involves completing the square, and I don't want to do that because that could be a whole new lesson, and it will be later on this year. Let's pull this in, though. If you want to find the x or the vertex of a parabola, the x-coordinate of the vertex is equal to negative b over 2a. Well, this is b, so negative 12 over 2 times a. A is the leading coefficient. A in this case is 2. So this becomes negative 12 over 4. So the x of my vertex is going to become negative 3. I'm just going to write it over here because I'm running out of space. So this is the x of my vertex. How do I find the y value? How do you always find y values? You plug in your x's and you find your y. So the y of my vertex is equal to 2 times negative 3 squared plus 12 times negative 3 plus 20. Hopefully I can do this off the top of my head fairly easy. This is 2 times 9. This is negative 36. And this is positive 20. So I've got 18 minus 36 plus 20. What's 18 minus 36? I believe that's negative 18. Plus 20, which is 2. So the x of my vertex, through this little formula you might remember from geometry, is negative 3, and the y is 2. So my vertex is at negative 3, 2. Okay, now I'm just going to squeeze in a tiny little sketch here. Negative 3, 2. This is where my vertex is. Well, do you remember or know how to tell if a parabola opens up or down? Parabolas, if the x is squared, parabolas open up or down. If you're opening up, you open up when your leading coefficient is positive. And that's a positive 2. If that were negative 2, the parabola would be opening down. If the parabola opened down, I would actually find real solutions. But my leading coefficient here is positive, which means the parabola is opening up. Now this is a sketch, clearly, because I don't know any other points besides the vertex. But I do know, because my leading coefficient is positive, my parabola is opening up. It's opening up from a value of negative 3, 2, which means there is no x-intercept, which is why we got our complex solution. So, bam! There you go. An extended version of finding imaginary solutions of parabolas or quadratic equations.